Okay, so good afternoon and welcome to lecture 10. So in the last lecture, what I showed you was that we have been focusing on one particular system, right? The infinite potential well. And the reason we've been focusing on it is because, we can illustrate a lot of the concepts of quantum mechanics with this system. It's a relatively simple system. And what are those concepts of quantum mechanics? Well, the core of quantum mechanics is the fact that quantum states are vectors. You can add them like vectors, you can multiply them like vectors. And these vectors, in any vector space, you have some orthogonal basis. Here also, you need to have an orthogonal basis. So what is that orthogonal basis? Well, that is given by these eigenstates. And the orthogonality condition can be verified. So I worked this out for you last time, and I went through this in detail. It's an easy calculation, something that all of you should be able to do on your own. But I worked this out in detail because I wanted to show you explicitly what it means for these vectors to be orthogonal. And in particular, because it highlights this property of the inner product. And it shows us that, for instance, this X variable, right, it plays the role of the vector index, the component index, right? This X indexes the components of the vector. You might get confused and think of M and N as the components, but they are not the components. M and N index the vectors themselves, right? And X indexes the components. So finally, what we have is the statement that any state, right, in this system, our infinite potential system, can be written as a linear combination of our eigenstates. And for determining the coefficients of these states, right, all we need to do is just take the inner product of both sides with another eigenstate, right? So exactly what you would do in the case of ordinary vectors, with the difference being that since we have a complex vector space, right, our inner product involves, there are two different kinds of vectors. There are bra vectors and ket vectors. And so you have to take the inner product between one bra vector and with one ket vector. Right? Then I gave you these exercises. I hope that you have done these exercises. Your homework is due tonight. I'll open up an assignment on Moodle for your submissions. So this is one. Now the thing is that a vector space can have more than one basis, right? So this is one basis. And what are the basis vectors? They are the psi n, indexed by the integer index, right? There is another basis, which is the position basis. What is the position basis? Position basis is simply the basis which says that the particle is at the position X. So the eigenstates are the eigenstates of the position vector. These eigenstates are orthonormal. And any state can be written as a superposition of components right, in the x basis, right? So if you look at these two expressions, this is the expression of the vector in the position basis. This is the expression of the same vector in the energy eigenstate basis, right? Right. So these psi of n, these are the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, right? So they are eigenstates of the energy operator, right? And you have to notice that the position doesn't play a role in the definition of the state, right? Here the position is something that you sum over, so it goes away, right? It doesn't appear in the final expression. Here also the position is not present, right? Because the position is not present in this definition of psi of n. Psi of n is just a vector. It is when we write down psi of n in some basis, in the position basis, that we will get the components psi of n x. So today I'm going to talk about let me continue with this. So the things I want to talk about today are again going from again. Basis transformations. Operators in different bases. Then the question of orthogonality of states. For a free particle. Okay, and this is something that seems to be a very simple sort of thing, but it's not. We will see that here, to understand the concept of orthogonality, you need the Dirac delta function. And finally, the idea of Hermitian operators and how these operators, what are the properties of these operators? They have real eigenvalues and their eigenvectors form a orthogonal complete basis of H, where H is your Hilbert space, whatever that is, right? So first, this basis transformations, okay? And also, one of you, Pooja Shetty, had asked me a question in the mail, and I thought it was a really nice question. So I'm going to address it near the end of this class, okay? Basis transformation. So what is a basis transformation? So first of all, again, I will illustrate the example with ordinary vector space, okay? So you have some vector, okay, and now I'm going to use this bra and ket notation because we want to get comfortable with it, right? And these are your basis vectors, right? Now I can always change to a different basis, right? I can perform a linear transformation. And we'll see that this linear transformation has to correspond to something known as a unitary operator. Right? So what is the linear transformation? And also note that here I'm using some index I, which is a discrete index. Okay. But keep in mind that it doesn't have to be a discrete index. It can be a continuous index. If it's a continuous index, then you will just integrate over that index. Okay. So what does a linear transformation look like? A linear transformation is some matrix, let's say, like capital E. I put the tilde sign to indicate that we're talking about a matrix, right? And it has components uij. Okay. Again, I and j need not be discrete, they need not take discrete values. You can have continuous labels also. So we will see that you can also have, for instance, when you're working in the position basis, your operators could look like this, ux, x prime, where x and x prime take values along the line. And in such cases, however, we will normally write this as in this form. But you have to keep in mind that these two are statements of the same, you're talking about operators only. Okay? So a linear transformation, how does it act on a vector? Capital U acting on, I'll use vector V. What is this? Well, it gives us some vector W, okay? And I can write in terms of indices, how would I write? I would say WI is equal to UIJ VJ, right? Where VJ are the components of these two vectors. Okay. Now, this is the transformation which acts on the components. It is not changing the basis vectors, it is changing the components of the individual vectors in the same basis. So, such a transformation is called an active transformation. Right. On the other hand, what one could do is one could have a transformation which acts on the, I'll put a prime over here, on the basis vectors. Right, and so this is called a passive transformation, and the net result of both of these is the same. And if you want to visualize this, it's not very difficult to do so. You have some basis. And you have some vector, right? So if you perform an active transformation, what happens? If you have an active transformation, your basis remains the same. Right? And your vector is transformed. v prime, right? This is active. Right, and then what happens in the passive case? In the passive case, your vector is not affected, right? Instead, your basis vectors are transformed. And you have EI prime is equal to UIJ. So if you look at these, you see that whether you work in this with this method or this method, you get the same result at the end of the day. Right, because what matters is the relationship of the vector to the basis vector, and that relationship is unaltered in both. The final result is the same, right? And so, if we write down, let's see what happens with a passive transformation. Let's see how a vector changes, okay? So we have a vector. We can write it like this. Or we can write it like this. These are both identical statements, right? This is the statement of the vector in the original coordinate system, in the original basis. This is the vector in the new coordinate basis. Now in the new coordinate basis, your vector will have different components, right? So I put a prime on that. And how is this related to, how are my new basis vectors related to my old basis vector? I know how they are related, right? Uij, ej, like this. Right? So this tells me, so if I compare both of these expressions, the one on the top and one on the bottom, right? If I look at this expression and this expression, what does this tell me? This tells me that V of I is equal to V of I prime times Uij. Right, where, and I should put a prime here because I'm using a prime to indicate the fact that this is the passive transformation matrix. Now I'll use an active transformation. Once again, I have my vector. Now I transform the components of the vector. My basis vectors are unchanged, okay? And I put a double prime just to, because I've already used up the prime. And what is the relationship between the double prime components and this component? Well, this is equal to Uij Vj. And here, there should be a sum over j. If I forget that sum, you should understand that it is implicit. Okay, because you have a repeating index. You have j is repeating here, so that sum has to be present, okay? Any questions so far? No? Okay. So I made a mistake here. This should be V of j. Why? Because when you multiply these two, you see you have to, you're summing over the I component. So this will have a j index. So I can write this as u prime ij. Ij transpose. Sorry. U prime ji transpose. Or I can better to write it as u prime transpose. And then ji times vi. Okay. In the case of an, so this is the passive transformation. The first one was passive transformation. The second one, we have an active transformation. Right. Now, both of these transformations should give us the same result. Right. What does that mean? That means that if we work out the components of the original vector, they should be the same. So how will I recover these components? Well, I would multiply on the left by the inverse of u. Right, I would multiply by the inverse of u, ij, vj double prime is equal to vi. Okay. And now if you look at these two expressions, you have one expression over here and another expression over here. Both of them are expressions for the same thing, right? So you can equate these to each other, right? So you get uij u prime transpose ij vj prime is equal to summation of u inverse ij vj double prime. Okay, so now we have u prime and we have u, and it seems these are not related to each other, right? But it will turn out that they are related, okay? Why is that the case? Well, we need to impose some sort of restriction on these transformations, right? Because you remember that the length of a vector, what is the length? The length is given by psi i, right? This is the norm squared of the vector, right? So first of all, this has to be greater than zero, greater than or equal to zero. And more importantly, what does this represent physically? This represents a probability, right? So for instance, if this is the state of an electron, if this vector corresponds to an electron in a certain state, when you perform this transformation, this basis transformation, you are not changing the system, right? You're not changing the physical state of the electron, right? So in this state, so as an example, I'll take a very simple I'll take the example of an electron or a spin 1/2 particle, which has 2 degrees of freedom only. Okay. This is called the spin up and spin down stage. Right? Alpha and beta are the components. What is the interpretation of alpha and beta? Alpha square is the probability of finding the state of finding the electron in the up spin state, and beta squared is the probability of finding the electron in the down spin state. Right? And if you add the sum of these two, alpha square plus beta square, what should you get? You get 1, right? And what is this? This is the norm of the vector, right? Now I can transform to a different basis. So for example, there is a basis which is called the Bell basis. And this is very important in quantum computation, for instance. It looks like this. This is called the plus state. This is called the minus state. Right? You can check it very easily that, well, I mean, you can see that this is a linear transformation, right, from this basis to this basis. Now, your state psi in the new basis, in the old basis, it looks like this. In the new basis, it will have different components, right? Let's call it gamma and delta, right? What are the properties that gamma and delta have to satisfy? Well, gamma and delta have to satisfy this requirement. The length of the vector should not change under a basis transformation. Right? And now you will notice that here, so this is a passive transformation, right? I'm changing the basis vectors. So first of all, let me work out the transformation matrix, right? So there's the matrix which I can use. So I have what is my plus state. My plus state is 1/√2. My minus state is 1/√2. And then there is a minus sign. Right? Why am I writing it like this? Because now you can see, I hope you can see, that this can be written in the form of a linear transformation. Right? These are your old basis vectors, these are your new basis vectors. This is your matrix, transformation matrix. I'll call this U prime ij. Why prime? Because I'm using the prime symbol for the passive transformation, right? Any confusion so far? Please let me know if there is any doubt, okay? By the way, do you all have another class at 3:00? 3:30, and I suppose everybody has had lunch. So is it okay if I take like till 3:10 or something like that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So this is your transformation matrix, right? So how would we write down this in terms of this matrix? So let me call this basis. I'll refer to this as EI. And when I put these curly braces, what that means is that I'm talking about a set of items. So here I'm talking about the set of two EI prime, the new basis vectors. And these are the old basis vectors. Right? And what is the relation? EI prime is equal to U prime IJ. Okay, so now what does my state look like in the new basis in terms of this matrix expression? Right, I have psi is equal to psi I prime EI prime. Okay. What is EI prime? It's U prime IJ. EJ. Right, and this has to be equal to psi I EI, right? That is in terms of the old basis vectors. So if you look at these two expressions, you can see that you can read off the relationship between the active and the passive transformations, right? So you can think of, so this is the passive transformation, but if I look at this expression and I write it like this, I write it like, so you see going from here to here, from here to here, this is a passive transformation. But now what I can do is I can perform a active transformation, right? So I go from the old basis to the new basis via passive transformation. And then I return to the old basis via an active transformation. Meaning it acts on the components, not on the basis vectors. Right? So first of all, what this tells you is that the relationship between passive and active transformations is going to be one of an inverse, right? So if the passive transformation happens according to a matrix, let's say U prime, an active transformation has to happen with is generated by the matrix, which is the inverse of the passive one. Okay, so that's one thing. The second statement is that if I look at the norm of this vector, the norm of this vector should not change, right? So what is the norm of this vector? Let me take the inner product of this vector with itself. What will that give me? That will give me psi I prime complex conjugate psi j prime. EI prime the bra vector, EJ prime the ket vector. Forgetting something, I'm doing something silly. One second. Let me work with the components. Let me work with an active transformation. It's simpler that way. So I have psi I prime is equal to uij psi j. This is a right. So this is a this is an active transformation, right? And now I will impose the condition. I will impose the requirement that summation of psi I prime squared is equal to 1, which is equal to summation of psi j squared. Okay. So this is psi I prime. And what is psi I squared? It's prime squared. It's psi I prime complex conjugate psi I. What is psi I prime complex conjugate? It's just the complex conjugate of this expression. So I get psi j prime uij complex conjugate multiplied by psi I, right? And now there's a sum over j, right, in this expression. What is psi I? Psi I is equal to sum over k uik psi k. And note that I have used a different index here. I've used the index k for the second term and the index j for the first term. Why? Because we can't sum over the same index more than once, right? All right. So now if you look at this expression, we get sum over jk psi j star psi k. Right, and then I can write the remainder as u complex conjugate transpose. Okay, j I times u I k. So what I've done is I've taken this matrix. There is already a complex conjugate. I've switched the order of the indices. So instead of writing ij, I'm writing okay, I'm back. Zoom disconnected as usual. Okay. Right. So what I've done is I've switched the order of these indices. When I switch the order of these indices, what do I get? I get the transpose, right? Because remind yourself of this in case you might have forgotten that if you take a matrix Aij, you can write that as A transpose Ji. Okay. Now, this expression, this is the norm of this is psi I squared, right? Now what I want is that sum of psi I prime squared has to be equal to the sum of psi I squared, right? So what do? I take a sum of this expression over I, which involves a sum of this expression over I. And what will be the requirement on this? On this part of the expression for this to be true. This will be true only if this matrix multiplication uik, right? And now there's going to be sum over I. So this is a matrix multiplication. If this gives me delta jk, that means this matrix is the inverse of the of u, right? So if this is delta jk, you put that in here, you put in delta jk, and you will see that the sums work out. Okay, now what does this mean? This means the following, that the matrix U, right? Well, what is this matrix? This is a matrix we generated at transformation. It satisfies the following requirement. That U, the matrix, is equal to the transpose complex conjugate. What is this operation known as? This is called the Hermitian adjoint, which is represented by a dagger. This is a dagger. Okay. So such matrices are called unitary matrices. Unitary matrices, the inverse of the matrix, my mistake. Be more careful, the inverse of this matrix, not that matrix itself. So this has to be equal to the inverse of this. So the matrix inverse is equal to the Hermitian adjoint. Okay. So basis transformations, whether they are active or passive, it doesn't matter, because as I showed you earlier, active and passive transformations are generated by, one is generated by matrix, another is generated by the inverse of that. Active or passive transformations are generated by unitary matrices. As a very simple example, we can check whether this matrix is unitary, right? Now, in this matrix, all the components are real. Right? So you just have to check that U transpose times U is equal to the identity, and you can check that it is very easy to do this multiplication. You will see that it's equal to 1. Okay, what else? So this is, these are basis transformations. The next thing is what happens to operators. So far we talked about vectors, but operators will also transform. Now I will leave this this topic for the next, for a later class. For now, I want to talk about Hermitian operators. I'll talk about Hermitian operators. So this basis transformation, this gives us the notion of unitary operators. And what are Hermitian operators, and why do we care about those? Hermitian operators. Well, a Hermitian operator satisfies the following requirement. That it is equal to its own adjoint, Hermitian adjoint, right? u is equal to u dagger. This is what a Hermitian operator is satisfying. Why do we care about Hermitian operators? Because they have certain properties. What is the first property? A Hermitian operator has real eigenvalues. In other words, right, for any operator, I can ask what are the eigenvalues. So if u is Hermitian, and you have to be careful, this is the dagger operator, not the transpose, then lambda is a real number. And the second property is that the eigenstates of these Hermitian operators form a complete basis. A complete orthonormal basis. Well, orthogonal basis. Orthogonal basis. What does this mean? Now, let me write the eigenvalue equation in this way. So what I've done is I've put a label lambda on the vector side, right? So I am indexing the vector by the eigenvalue. So what are my eigenvectors? My eigenvectors consists of the set of these vectors, right? Psi lambda. Where lambda is the lambda takes values in the set of eigenvalues, whatever those eigenvalues are, right? So lambda is a number which belongs to the eigenvalues, the spectrum of the operator. So what is the meaning of this statement that they form a complete orthogonal basis? The statement is the following: that for any or for all phi in my Hilbert space H, on which this is an operator, right? I can take phi and write it as a sum over these eigenstates. Okay, what that means is that I can, if I have a Hermitian operator, I can use that Hermitian operator to determine a basis for my Hilbert space, for my system. And why is it important? Why does it matter that the set of eigenvalues is real? Why do we care about that? Well, the reason is that we want the result of any measurement should be a real number, right? Complex numbers, how would you interpret that? Maybe there is some way to interpret it, but I don't know. So the measurement result should be a real number. And what does this mean when I say measurement result? Well, so if you look at this state, right, this is the state of your system. When you perform a measurement, what happens? When you perform a measurement, the system collapses to a state, eigenstate, psi lambda prime. I will give you an example of this in a second, okay, what this means. And you get the result of the measurement to be the corresponding eigenvalue C lambda. Okay. So this C lambda prime, this has to be a real number, right? Now, let me give you an example of such a measurement. So once again, we will look at our spin 1/2 particle. Okay, up and down state. So our Hilbert space is two-dimensional. Right, so we can write the Hilbert space like this, C2. It's a set of all pairs of complex numbers, right? You can write that as C cross. So the Cartesian product of the complex numbers with them. Now, on this Hilbert space, we have these operators. These are called the poly operators, sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z. Sigma z looks like this. Sigma x. And sigma y where the I is the square root of minus one. Okay. Now all three of these operators are Hermitian, by the way. You can check. So I'll just write sigma I is equal to right. So for any of the values of I, this is a Hermitian operator. Okay. So let's look at sigma z and let's ask what are the eigenvalues of sigma z. Eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Okay. So an the eigenvalue equation for sigma z would be this expression, right? Now let's if we work it out in components, what do we get? We get 1, 0, 0, minus 1. This state, I can write in terms of the components, alpha and beta. Right? And this is equal to some number times alpha beta. Okay? Now, exercise again. Show that there are two eigenvalues, lambda is equal to plus or minus one, and the eigenvectors are 1, 0, and 0, 1. Okay? So what does this have to do with the earlier, with what I was talking about, this measurement and collapse and all that? So now you start with a system in this state. Okay, so this is an electron, let's say, and the electron is in a superposition of upspin and downspin. What is up and downspin? These are, this is the spin angular momentum. So the spin angular momentum of an electron can have two values, plus half and minus half. So then you perform a measurement, right? So the experimentalist performs a measurement. How does the experimentalist perform a measurement? There are many ways to do it. One way to do it is via a Stern-Gerlach type setup. What is a Stern-Gerlach setup? You have a these are magnets. These are supposed to represent magnets. And there is a magnetic field here. And the reason these magnets are in this funny shape is because you want the magnetic field to be inhomogeneous, meaning that it's, the magnetic field doesn't look like this. It's not uniform. Okay? So it's like this. And then what we do is we send in these electrons. We send in our electron, okay? And then here we have a screen. When the electron goes through this setup, it is deflected either in this direction or in this direction, depending on whether it's the spin of the electron is plus half or negative half, depending on whether it's in the up state or the down state. Okay, so what do? You take an electron, you prepare it in this state, and you send it through a Stern-Gerlach setup, through a Stern-Gerlach device. What does the device tell you? Well, it tells you, if the electron comes out over here, the device tells you that the spin of the electron has been measured to be in the up state. And if the electron comes out in this position, then it tells you that the spin of the electron has been measured to be in the down state. So here the spin turns out to be plus half, here it turns out to be minus. I should say SZ, because we are looking only at the Z component of the spin angular momentum. So this is a measurement. Now, you might ask, well, what happens when I repeat this measurement? Well, if you repeat this measurement, what will happen? Sometimes you will get this, sometimes you will get this, right? And if you repeat the measurement for a large number of times, right, you will get N up and N down. Right, let's say you repeat it a very large number of times. N. Then this many times it was in the up state, this many times it was in the down state, right? And these two have to add up to give you N, which is the number of times you did the experiment. From this, you can determine the probability. Right? And this probability, so to save a little bit of space or not. Okay. P alpha, in the limit that n goes to infinity, what is it going to be equal to? Anybody? What will be the probability in the limit that the number of measurements goes to infinity?
1/2.
Why 1/2? How did you get that number? How did you get that 1/2 number? Just because there are two states. What was the state with which I prepared the electron?
They took this mod alpha state. Square.
Mod alpha square. Right? And similarly, this will be equal to mod beta square. So what is the Hermitian operator that we have measured? We are measuring the z component of the angular momentum. The corresponding operator is sigma z, right? Similarly, sigma x measures the x component of the angular momentum, and sigma y measures the y component of the angular momentum. And this is a Hermitian operator, so it has real eigenvalues, right? And when the system is measured, it collapses into one of these states. It collapses either into the up state or the down state. And the corresponding eigenvalue is the result of our measurement. So it actually turns out to be the case that there is, you have to put in, if you put in all the dimensions, this turns out to be equal to h bar by 2 and minus h bar by 2, right? We need something with units of angular momentum. So these are the two kinds of operators. One is unitary operators. Unitary operators, they generate transformations on your Hilbert space. And Hermitian operators are used for carrying out measurements. Okay. All right. So I will leave it here for today. I think this is enough. Right. There are a couple of other things which I would like to have covered, but I haven't done today. We don't have enough time for that. So we have to do these topics. We'll cover them in later class, or I might give them to you as a homework problem. Okay. So are there any questions?
So the question I asked.
Yes, Pooja, I know. I'm coming to your question. I want to ask if anybody else has any questions before I look at that. Okay, so if anybody has a question, please ask. Okay, in the meantime, let me show you Pooja's question. I'm going to share the screen. What her question is. So she says, what is the practical significance of finding position expectation values of a wave function? Okay, and so it doesn't matter whether we look at position or any other expectation value, okay? So expectation values are weighted averages. Well, they are just averages. I wouldn't call them weighted averages. In our normal experience of practical experiments, averaging multiple experiments gets us closer to the, I suppose you want to say, actual value, right? But remember, actual, again, there is really no such thing as an actual value, right? Or the true value. And that is what you also say. You say there is no concept of a true value in a quantum mechanical system. Fine. We have a probability distribution. When we make a measurement on the system, the wave function collapses and we find the particle at a certain point. Okay. As we keep on making measurements or make a measurement on multiple copies of the system at the same time. Yeah, so this is also important, is that in the example I gave you of the Stern-Gerlach effect, you can repeat the measurement, the same measurement, many times, or you can have multiple copies of the same measurement and carry out the measurement just once on all those copies. The average of all the positions will be the expectation value. Why is this value so important, considering that the particle may not even exist at this point? Now this is the part. This is the part where you bring in your assumption and viewpoint, which are based on classical phenomena, right? And what is that assumption? That assumption is this statement: exist, right? So in our classical picture, we think that something exists at a certain point in space and time, right? But see, what quantum mechanics tells us is that it doesn't matter what you say exists or doesn't exist. Okay, so the question of existence is not a physical question. It's a metaphysics. It belongs to metaphysics. Why? Because the questions that what really matters are the questions that one can ask of any system and the answers that you can get from that system. That is the only thing that matters, okay? Right? So when you're looking out at the world, right, you have information coming into you. And then your brain formulates questions. So it says, for instance, what is the name of this object, right? And from the information that is coming into you, you can deduce that the name of this object is a pen, an S pen. What is the color of this object? It's black, right? Now, if there is another observer, that different observer, let's say it's an alien, and that observer can view things in a different spectrum of light than we do. That observer, when you ask that person, what is the color of this pen? They might say something else. They might say, well, it is, they don't have a concept of red or green or blue or black. So they say in terms of wavelength, and it might correspond to something which is violet in our wavelength, our visible spectrum, right? So, first of all, right, it does not meaningful to ask such a question. Does something exist at a certain point or not? What is meaningful?
When I was writing that, I was thinking more about a multi-particle system.
Okay.
So when you take like an average of, like when you do the spins and the value can be either plus half or minus half,
mm-hmm.
and the average of that is zero, but that's not an actual value that
hold on, slow down. Right, oh, now you're talking about, in this question, you're talking about positions. Now you suddenly switch to angular momentum.
No, I just, like, that was my doubt about expectation values and averages, because like, when I was writing the question, I was thinking about just averages in general, but then I added positions, so that made it a bit confusing. But
okay, fine. So let's talk about angular momentum. What about angular momentum?
No, I mean, like I said, but if the particle can have plus half spin and minus half spin,
mm-hmm.
and if you write that as an, if you take an average of that of the system of the measurement, you get mm-hmm. zero.
No, hold on now.
Yeah.
Do you get zero regardless of the state that you prepare your system to be in?
If you prepare it with equal probability.
Exactly. If you prepare it with equal probability, right?
Yeah.
Now, if you don't prepare it with equal probability, will you get zero?
No.
No. And in each individual measurement, what will be the value of the angular momentum?
Yeah, will it be plus zero? Half or minus half.
Will it be zero in any of the individual measurements?
No.
No. Okay. Right. So now you might say, well, what is the meaning of the expectation value?
Yeah.
So the meaning of the expectation value, well, it depends on the circumstance, on the system that you're looking at. Okay. So in this particular case of the spin half particle, the meaning of the expectation value, it is not that meaningful. Okay. But when you're looking at a particle on the real line, let's say a particle in a box or a free particle, then it is meaningful, right? The expectation value tells you. So let's read on what you're writing. Why is this information more important than, say, the most probable position of the particle? So one I can imagine is the wave function changes with time. The average value may change even at the most probable. Well, no, I mean, this again, you have to look at actual systems and work out what happens to them. This may or may not be the case for any particular system. Okay, so is it not possible for a system to exist in which the average value does not change, but the most probable position of the particle does? Yes, of course it is. It is possible to have such a system. Such a system is the infinite potential well. Why?
Yeah.
Because I gave this to you as an exercise. No, find the expectation value of the position.
Yeah.
The expectation value of the position in all of the states is what?
L by 2. Yeah.
But is that the most probable value?
No.
No. It's the most probable value in which state?
The first one.
The first one. Right? And in the third one, and in the fourth one.
Yeah, third.
But in those states, you have more than one most, you have equally probable.
Yeah.
You have antinodes. You have many antinodes, right? So that's your example. If you differentiate the wave function, will the maximas and minimas tell us more? Sure, they will tell us more, absolutely. So the expectation value or the average of the of any observable does not give you all the information about the wave function. Right?
Yeah, I was just
So there is a branch of there's a field of research known as quantum tomography. So the goal is that you are given some quantum state, some system, and you don't know the state of the system to begin with, right? You're just given the system, and then you are asked to determine the state of the system. What does that mean, determine the state of the system? It means, for instance, if you have this spin 1/2 particle, then to determine what is alpha and beta, right? But not just alpha and beta, also the relative phase between alpha and beta. Remember, there can be an arbitrary complex number which multiplies the two, an arbitrary complex number of, so let me just, again, just write that down for you. I'll show you what I mean by that. So you have this alpha and beta, but you see, you can also take beta and multiply it by some e to the I theta, right? So then your state would be given by alpha e to the I theta times beta. This is a relative phase between your two eigenstates. Can you determine this relative phase via such experiments? Will these experiments give you any information about this phase angle?
No.
No, right? Because these will only tell you the probabilities, which are the modulus squared. So the expectation value does not carry all the information about the state of the system. Okay.
Okay.
If that is what you were trying to say, then
that is. Yeah, okay. Because we study expectation value a lot.
No, you see, when you start learning to read and write, you study the alphabet a lot. You don't jump to Shakespeare right away, na? So you are starting with the foundations, the basics. So expectation values are the lowest level of the ladder. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yeah.
Okay. There is a lot more. There's a lot more to cover in quantum mechanics. Okay, in quantum theory. But expectation values are a very important part, right? So if you want the complete information of the system, well, never mind, I won't go into that right. Okay, so I hope that I have given you some clarity. I don't know if I've given all the clarity that you wanted. Are there any other questions? No? Okay, so I'll stop here. I guess we had a long enough class, and I will see you all on Wednesday morning.